3 years ago, Dave and I spoke, I think it was in 2010, and if you can think back to the environment in 2010, it was certainly quite a bit different than the environment we're entering in 2014. The news titles of the day of the newspaper was government bailing out General Motors, it was banks being rescued, it was Federal Reserve taking extraordinary action. And today you don't see those on the headlines. Today you see good news, and that's great. So Dave and I are going to try to, I think, shine a little bit of light on what's going on in the economy. I have three areas I'm going to cover. First is basically what's going on in the economy. Secondly, what's driving the economy. I think there's some unique things happening in our economy today. And I think they're presenting a much more positive environment than many expect, or many are thinking today. Secondly, I'm going to talk about the financial markets themselves, with a lot of focus on the stock market. And lastly, I'm going to give you some of my favorite sectors that I'm focusing on, and I think that are really great areas of growth for the economy. So 2014, we're really coming into a situation where growth is coming back. I think we in the United States get used to a lot of things in this country. And when you travel around, when you go around the rest of the globe, if you go to China, you go to India, you go to Brazil, places like that, you look at our country compared to those countries, what you recognize is the United States has superior assets compared to many of those countries. And I'll remind you of just a few of those. Our educational system is the envy of the world. All over the world, people send their students here to learn, and then they go back and often work in those countries. Our legal system is one of the fairest in the world. Compared to what happens in Russia, compared to what happens in China, places like that, no comparison at all. Access to capital for entrepreneurs is unprecedented, and it's changing. I invite you to go to a site called Kickstarter.com. Kickstarter is a wonderful organization. It creates tremendous access to capital for anybody, for anything. And I think that's just the beginning. I think what Kickstarter is doing today is in the future of fundraising. It's going to be done a lot more in that way. Our capital markets are very good. So I think the bottom line is we're in a lot better position in the U.S. today than many think. The United States, I think, is the most adaptable, creative, innovative economy on the globe. We are recovering slowly, but there's really two economies out there. There's the educated economy, and that's really the economy sitting in this room here today. And then there's the non-educated economy, and these are the people that are labored kind of jobs. And those people are not doing well in this economy. And the reason is we've worked out jobs for them. There aren't as many jobs for them, and we need to retrain them. People like Patricia here at the North Shore Chamber of Commerce, and the North Shore Community College, and Salem State University, and others really need to work on re-educating those people to get them a better position for this economy. Central bank intervention is still very much in play today. When I talk to my investment team, I talk to them about we need to study what the government's doing, because the government is a very big influence on the financial markets today. There is a big reallocation going on today. People are moving the money out of defensive areas into more aggressive areas. And I think that's going to be continuing. I'm going to show you a few slides of that. There's a huge innovation going on in energy, making very big changes to our economy today, and all very positive. Basically, it's giving us all a cut in expenses. And lastly, innovation in many areas of the economy continue to really grow. As far as interest rate trends, they're definitely moving up, and the reason is the Federal Reserve is getting towards the end of the big accommodative phase, and that's going to be negative for bond investors. U.S. manufacturing costs are coming down, and I'll show you a chart which actually shows the U.S. is very competitive today with the rest of the globe. Changing economies, we're really going into the phase, I think, where capital reinvestment, which has been deferred for many years, is really starting to come into play today. In terms of equity valuations, we think they could rise. And lastly, there's this very large interdependency among countries, which is really a very good thing, but it changes the economics of the country. And it makes the economies all grow together. And you know, when I was in school, they used to talk about investing internationally because of diversification. Well, it really doesn't happen. The whole globe moves up and down together. We saw that in the last cycle. Here's some interesting charts that really, I think, highlights what's going on in the economy. The first one is total employment. We had 138 million jobs back in 2008. We dropped all the way down to under 130, so we lost about 8 million jobs. But the good news is we recovered almost all of those jobs. We're very close back to the peak where we were. We still have an unemployment rate of 7%, though, and the Federal Reserve's looking for 6% or so until they feel they've done their job. So they're going to continue to be accommodative for a while. The bad news is wages aren't really keeping up. They're not really growing a great deal. And this is that second tier of the economy that I was talking about. I've got a quote on here by Yogi Berra, "A nickel ain't worth a dime anymore." I think that's what those people are feeling today. They're feeling like that situation. This is the housing component of the economy. The point there is that we're still in the lower end of that housing starts. We haven't recovered even to midway on housing, and I think we will eventually. So I think that's one of the sources of drivers of demand for the economy. Here's consumer confidence. We're still at the low end of that range. Before this economic cycle is over, we'll be in the upper end of that range, probably a year or two from now. I like to talk about interest rates, because interest rates really are important. I feel very confident about the stock market today because of where interest rates are. They are still very, very low. Go into any bank in America today and ask for rates for a CD. Do you feel good about the rates being offered? Of course you don't. You feel terrible about this, right? 5 years, 2%. How does that help your investments grow? It doesn't. So you have to be in productive assets today. And the stock market is productive assets today. But this chart shows a chart of the long-term interest rates going all the way back to 1871. And why do I show this? The message out of this chart is we're really in a moderate area of interest rates today. We aren't necessarily extremely low, particularly when you compare back to where we were in the early part of the 1900th century or the late part of the 1800th century. So it is possible we could have lower interest rates than people expect going forward. And I think that's something you should keep in mind. The big negative in the economy that I see today is still debt. When we compare to 25 years ago where debt levels were in this country to today, we're basically double the level of debt. This is when you add federal debt, corporation debt, and individual debt. And why is that important? It's important to recognize because debt is really denied future consumption. It's denied future consumption. So if I took you with your income and I gave you 5 credit cards and put $100,000 worth of debt on each of those 5 credit cards, how would you do consuming? Probably not very well. And that's really what the situation's happened in our country today. Too much money is going to pay down debt. So we need to still get the debt levels lower. And that's an important factor when you think about how fast the economy can grow. This chart's difficult to see, but the numbers over on the right here that are in the white basically give you the expected numbers for GDP growth, inflation, and government deficits. And the important point here is they're pretty modest expectations going forward. For 2014, this is the top 100 economists in the country putting their numbers into Bloomberg. And they come up with 2.6% in 2014. I do think that's likely going to come out too low. I think it would be a stronger number than that. I think possibly 2015 could be stronger too. Inflation numbers are continuing to be very modest as well. But we have to remember when the Federal Reserve brings back that money and gets less accommodative, I think there's going to be more pressure on interest rates, so inflation could be heading up. And lastly, our budget deficit is expected to drop to about 2.7% from about 4%. You can see just a few years ago, we were at 10%. Those are pretty scary times. Here's a chart of interest rates, basically showing that the trend of interest rates is decidedly up on the short term. 1.6% on the 10-year treasury in May of last year. Today, we're just under 3%. But when you put it in context of the longer term, this is a 20-odd year time frame. We really haven't really begun the upward trend yet. We just started. We need to get above 3.5% really to break out. And that may take a little bit of time, but I think eventually it should occur. And that average line of 5%, I think 2 or 3 years from now, we probably should be in the 4 to 5% range here. There's other really good news. The debt levels in the economy are quite reasonable on individuals. This is the ratio of debt service ratio, that's debt payments to personal income. It's the lowest we've seen in 30 years. A really good thing. And that helps consumers do a little bit more spending. So that's a positive. This, I think, is the biggest driver we're going to see, and it's capital spending. Over the last 3 or 4 years, corporations and cities and towns and lots of other entities in our economy have deferred maintaining their equipment. They've deferred putting a roof on. They've deferred buying new trucks. They've deferred fixing up their buildings. That's coming back. And I like to show this chart. It's very busy. But it basically shows that the U.S. is in the lowest level of capital spending compared to all other countries. And we've become very defensive and very cautious over the last 3 or 4 years. I think this is a big driver for us. And we should. It may mean that that 2.6 GDP number could be 3.5% or higher if this gets unleashed. As far as valuations in the stock market, a lot of people are worried when rates start to go up, it means the stock prices should go down. This chart actually shows at a certain level that's true, but not until we get to a certain level of interest rates. This chart shows that when you go from about 3% to 5 or 6%, valuations on stocks actually go up substantially. And they could go up from a ratio today of about 15 on a price earnings ratio to maybe 18 or 20 times earnings. So that could be a nice boost to the economy and to investors in a while. And I think that's probably going to occur. I mentioned there's a couple issues in the economy. One is energy. Energy impacts everybody's business in this room. We all pay for energy, whether it's oil and gas, it's natural gas, or whether it's other forms of energy. And a wonderful thing happened in the last 8 or 9 years. We developed new ways to get oil and gas out of the ground. And not just small impact to our economy, big impact to our economy. Here's a couple charts showing you this. This is just Texas production of oil and gas coming out, showing it doubled in a period of 2 or 3 years. And this is the whole country's production of crude. We had a declining phase here from 1983 all the way to 2007, and all of a sudden, we doubled capacity. And a lot of people are thinking that this is just the beginning. Many think we're going to go up from 8 or 9 million barrels a day up to 12 or 14. If that doesn't occur, we're going to be the largest producer of oil and gas in the world. We'll overtake both Saudi Arabia and Russia. I didn't think I'd ever say that. And I don't think most people ever anticipated that. But that's the innovation, I think, that's wonderful about our country. There's quite unique things happening. This is basically showing one side effect from that is imports, oil imports, are dropping dramatically. So this changes the geopolitical situation over in the Middle East. We don't have to be as concerned as we used to be about that part of the world. We still have to be concerned, of course, and we are involved over there, but it's not as critically important economically. This shows imports of oil dropping dramatically, just as our production is increasing. Here's the bottom line for manufacturing. I know we have a lot of manufacturers in the chamber here. Because of this reduction in energy costs, natural gas is the biggest side of that, but also in oil. We are very competitive now with the rest of the world from the manufacturing. I love this chart because it shows we index ourselves at 100 and we compare ourselves to the other countries here. Italy is a 20% higher cost of manufacturing than we are here in the US. Germany is 16% higher. And Germany is a very efficient operation over there. France, Japan, and UK are all higher than us by close to 10%. And even on this comparison, we're very competitive even with China today. So the manufacturing sector is possibly a very good area of growth for our economy. Shifting gears to the financial markets, I talked about how people were conservative and defensive over the last 5 years. This chart shows the last 5 years of how much money people moved into bonds. Unprecedented decisions from investors. Really scared, really not taking any risk, and I think a lot of that money is still there today. Just for the first time in 2000, 2013, investors have started to move money out of bonds in equities. So we've had 1 year of positive flow in equities over the last 6 years. And there's a chart down the bottom here put together by Deutsche Bank that shows the gap of normal funding for equities could be more than $1 trillion over the last 4 or 5 years. So that could be fuel for further gains in the stock market. I don't want to give you the impression that it's all wonderful out there and there aren't some problems. There are some problems. And here's just a few of them. I talked about the debt. That's an anchor on the economy. Unproductive regulation. Bill has talked about the Affordable Care Act, which is anything but affordable, and the issues there. And some of the regulation just is really not helpful to our economy. It's destructive. It creates difficulties for us complying with those regulations. Demographics are an issue. We have an elderly population. We're not as bad as Japan, but we're going in that direction, and that's something to keep aware of. The Federal Reserve has the potential for problems as they pull this $3 trillion they have on their balance sheet out, and that could mean higher interest rates going forward. Global stability is an issue and something that we're starting to hear problems in North Korea and other areas like that, so we need to keep an eye on that. The emerging markets continue to be weak, and that's slowing overall growth for the whole economy. And we have a large inequitable distribution of wealth. And I think that is an unknown problem and what that can develop, but it's not a good one. So it,